Hi, and welcome to my presentation about memes between morality and practice. My name is Kevin Paulix. I'm a research associate in the project Pictorial Picture Critique in Social Media at the University of Marburg. In the following minutes, I want to analyze how the term meme has changed over time from its biological conception of viral infection to concrete internet phenomena in media practice. Therefore, I will trace three evolutionary stages of the term from its original meaning in memetics to its reappropriation in meme culture. The term originated in Richard Dawkins' famous book, The Selfish Gene, from 1976. In his book, Dawkins argues that there must be another kind of evolution besides the biological one, otherwise humans could not have developed into cultural beings. This cultural evolution is not driven by genes, but by a new replicator which Dawkins names meme after the ancient Greek word for imitation. Examples of such memes are, I quote, tunes, ideas, catchphrases, clothes fashions, ways of making pots or building arches. However, the most influential example is missing from his list. Dawkins is not just an evolutionary biologist, but one of the most famous artists and critics of religion. This actually explains why a natural scientist is strangely obsessed with culture. According to Dawkins, religion is a virus infecting people with blind faith in the God meme, which has such effective power because it provides a simple answer to complex questions. Clearly, Dawkins himself coined the term meme to provide a simple biological answer to complex cultural questions. As one of the most famous atheists ever lived, the biologist knows how to mobilize science as a weapon against religion. This is exactly what his concept of memes is intended for, powerfully expressed in his bestseller The God Delusion. Nevertheless, Dawkins' attack on religion developed into its own area of research known as memetics, the self-proclaimed new science of the meme. This is how former Microsoft developer Richard Prodi names it in the subheading of his book Virus of the Mind, which is almost word for word the title of one of Dawkins' most read papers on memes. According to Aaron Lynch, memetics can be defined as, I quote, an epidemiology of ideas. This thinking influenced media studies as well. Douglas Rushkoff believes that people are infected with memes through the ideological code of media. In his influential book, Media Virus, he claims that, I quote, media events are not like viruses, they are viruses. All these authors have in common that they relate to memes as viruses that infect people and control their minds, even against their will. This body of thought is the first meaning of the term. Memes relate to the pseudoscientific idea of cultural virality, which is used for criticizing religion and other ideologies. Even if memetics never developed into a serious science, the term meme has caught on in social media. However, Dawkins and memetics are probably not responsible nor known to most users. This is obvious when looking at the online discussion about how to pronounce the term meme. Suggestions range from meme to meme and meme, whereas Dawkins provides clear instruction in his definition. It should be pronounced to rhyme with cream. In an interview, Dawkins actually speaks of the internet having hijacked his term. I quote, the meaning is not that far away from the original. It is anything that goes viral. In the original introduction to the word meme, in the last chapter of The Selfish Gene, I did actually use the metaphor of a virus. So when anybody talks about something going viral on the internet, that is exactly what a meme is, and it looks as though the word has been appropriated for a subset of that. Keep in mind that neither Dawkins nor memetics originally thought of memes as viruses metaphorically. In The Selfish Gene, Dawkins makes it very clear that, I quote, memes should be regarded as living structures, not just metaphorically, but technically. It goes without saying that his view of culture, and that means internet culture as well, is problematic since there is no room for human agency nor creativity, which is what Henry Jenkins, Sam Ford, and Joshua Green criticize in their book Spreadable Media. Despite this criticism, memetics still has an impact on meme studies. For example, Michel Knobel and Colin Langshear define internet memes as, I quote, contagious ideas passed on in visual forms that are modified or remixed in ways that nonetheless preserve the original idea in recognizable form, which closely relates to Dawkins' original definition. Other scholars like Limor Schiffman and Ryan Milner critically rethink memetics for the internet. Be that as it may, terms like meme and viral are just an ascription to internet culture and not equivalent to actual media practices online. Of course, these terms are commonly used on the internet. However, online they do not mean the same as in memetics. Whitney Phillip notes that on the internet, I quote, memes are not passive and do not follow the model of biological infection. For users on platforms like 4chan and Reddit, memes mean something completely different. So what do memes mean on the internet if not viral infection? To find out, we have to go back in time. At the turn of the millennium, the first internet phenomena emerged, which were called memes, but much more sporadically than today. In 1998, the term net meme was dropped in a CNN interview to talk about the dancing baby, which however has little in common with later internet memes. Another example is Goodwin's Law, which is often adduced to historically mark the beginning of internet memes, although it is explicitly a mimetic experiment to virally spread a counter-idea and does not relate to later internet memes. Both examples can be traced back to the tech magazine Wired, which enthusiastically operationalized memetics but did not produce what we might call internet memes today. Internet phenomena such as all you base are belong to us, 9/11 tourist guy, oh really, and one does not simply X into Mordor, that are retrospectively historicized as the first internet memes, originally arose from the forums of Something Awful. What is remarkable about this is that the subculture of Something Awful took a strict stance against memes. According to David Thrope, a former admin of Something Awful, forum members were immediately banned if they shared what is now known as memes. I quote, "You would get banned if you did any meme shit, and certainly on the front page, nobody would dare to do any of that shit, like Loyalcats was popular for 10 minutes. It never capitalized on any of that stuff, which it probably could have, and made a ton of money. But as soon as something became recognizable as a meme, it was forbidden. Anyone who is from there is probably going to have an aversion to any kind of internet meme or catchphrase forever, probably because it was such a huge part of the culture. Everybody considered that the death of all humor and original thought." Because of this exclusion, the term meme did not enter the vernacular of Something Awful. Instead, internet phenomena were named after the actual media practices used, for example as Photoshops or image macros. The latter are images superimposed with text, which users could load onto the board via macro instructions, quite like emojicons today. According to Richard Kiyanka, the founder of Something Awful, I quote, "Image macro is what the kids these days call memes." The fact that image macros are identified as internet memes is a consequence of a structural change of semantics, which I understand following Niklas Luhmann as an evolution of the term. The question is, when and where did the concept of memes change? Like I showcased, it is not Something Awful, but another board that afforded this culture. In 2003, Christopher Poole, who was an active user of Something Awful, founded the image board 4chan. According to the oral history of David Thrope, at the beginning, the population of 4chan consisted of former members of Something Awful who were banned from the board. At least since 2004, the term meme circulated on 4chan and other boards like TinyChan. This is illustrated by the Milhouse is not a meme meme, which is explicitly about what an internet meme is and what is not. A little later, Loyalcats thrived on 4chan. Such image macros of cats were actually shared on Something Awful before, but on 4chan they were called memes for the first time. This is documented by an email which Time magazine received and published in 2007. I quote, "Cato Day, for example, was a meme on the 4chan.org image board which originated around the beginning of 2005 as a protest against Furry Friday threats." This email by an Anion, an anonymous 4chan user, is relevant because it connects image macros to internet memes at the time in 2005. Moreover, lolcats are not just pictures of cute cats, but rhetorical devices to police meme culture. Anons had to know lolspeak and the intertextual references to several cat macros like happy cat, lime cat, long cat, and so on to know how to properly use this meme. Users who did it wrong were mocked and excluded from 4chan. This subcultural exclusivity did not prevent lolcats from becoming mainstream, however. There is even evidence that lolcats are responsible for internet memes being this popular today. In 2007, the website I Can Have Cheeseburger was founded for just sharing lolcats. In the following years, this website became popular enough that millions of people visited every day. Today, it is not just a website anymore, but one of the biggest meme empires worldwide, which bought up popular websites like Failblog and KnowYourMeme. On there, lolcats are now only one internet meme among many others. Since 2012, the evolution of the term meme progressed to the point where the new semantics has become mainstream. From this time on, memes were not primarily connected to memetics anymore, but mean the specific phenomenon of image macros such as lolcats and the twice animals. 2 years later, however, the death of image macro memes was already mourned. Was this the end of the evolution and are memes dead now? Of course not. Actually, memes were never more popular than in 2020 when the corona pandemic started. Corona-chan is the first meme that addresses the coronavirus. In January 2020, when the term Corona-chan became popular on 4chan, a picture was posted that anthropomorphized the virus. Corona-chan is a young woman who wears a red qipao and high heels. In her hands, she holds a Corona beer and a Chinese flag. While the red dress and the flag explicitly point to China, the brand name beer and the bat wings reference to the coronavirus itself, which is suspected to have originated from bats in Wuhan. When this internet meme was posted on 4chan, the pandemic had not started yet. However, the first case in the United States was reported, which was probably the motivation for Corona-chan being posted on 4chan that day, since the original poster comes from the US. Coping with the virus in this way is not unusual, but part of meme culture, as one anon explains when asked about it. I quote, "Virus outbreak in China, so naturally we need to draw that virus as a kawaii anime girl." Another anon responds with annoyance. I quote again, "Can't you losers interpret anything outside of memes and anime references?" According to these users, Corona-chan is an infantilized version of the coronavirus, which is referenced by the Japanese term kawaii, meaning the culture of cuteness. However, Corona-chan is more than just a user-generated anime girl, but the first meme of the virus. Before Corona-chan, there had already been memes about viruses pictured as anime girls. The best known example is Ebola-chan, which was posted on 4chan 2014 while an Ebola epidemic was raging in Africa. Olivia Marcus and Meryl Singer argue that users on 4chan personified and sexualized the virus to cope with the contingencies of the crisis. The unknown was made into an object of desire, something that could be carefully controlled. In other words, Ebola-chan, much like Corona-chan, was translated into the codes of 4chan, which originally was about sharing anime. However, it is not entirely clear how the subculture stands on this topic, as Tyler Wofford notes. Did everyone really love anime, or was that just another level of brain-melting irony? Anyhow, turning the virus into a sexualized version of an anime girl can also be interpreted as an attempt to preserve meme culture by keeping the internet meme outside of the mainstream, where offensive content is usually not shared. At first, anons argued about how Corona-chan should look like. Various versions of the anthropomorphized virus were circulated in the thread. One anon, for example, posted an angel-like version, arguing that the term Corona stands for Halo. However, this version could not prevail because it did not reference China, which was the crucial point of the meme at the time. Instead, the first version did catch on and was stabilized as a form which portrays Corona-chan with a red qipao. Anons shared this representation 55 times in 2 days on 4chan. 2 days later, the subreddit Corona-chan was opened, where users could share versions of the anthropomorphized virus as well. One rule of this subreddit is, I quote, "Portray Corona-chan in an artistic, meme-y fashion. This is the next evolutionary stage of the term meme, which is not understood as viral infection nor image macro, but as a creative practice which is called memeing. The noun meme is turned into an adjective and a verb. As a media practice, memeing means that users can only create and share a meme within certain structures of meme culture, like the rules of a subreddit. In case of Corona-chan, each new version is judged by the style that was previously negotiated and standardized on 4chan. This is even true for Corona-chan memes that intertextually relate to other memes like Ebola-chan and Earth-chan. This version right here intertextually combines the three memes into one, picturing Corona-chan dominating Earth-chan, making Ebola-chan jealous not being a pandemic. To demonstrate their membership to meme culture, users comment the post by asking, "Is that Ebola-chan?" and by showing compassion for poor Earth-chan, or even being all for Corona-chan dominating Earth-chan. One user is criticizing this version by demanding that Corona-chan should be red, explicitly referencing the first version on 4chan. Another user, however, is insisting that she mutates, which does not only address how the real coronavirus mutates into different variants outside of the internet, but how the media practice of memeing itself is constantly changing through repetition and variation. This intertextual example actually is a repost, which was first shared on the Facebook page You Say We Draw by the artist Jan Piur. While reposting memes is hotly disputed in meme culture, I want to argue that it is necessary for content to stabilize as a meme. Corona-chan would not have become a meme would the first version have not been repeated many times on 4chan and Reddit. This practice may not seem very creative. Nevertheless, the Reddit user created the picture into a new context and created communicative connectivity which probably caused more memes about the coronavirus on Reddit. For this process, repetition is at least as important as variation because the media practice of memeing implies not only the creation, but also the circulation and reception of memes. These examples indicate that the term meme has significantly changed over time. On the internet, it does not mean the same as in memetics. According to Merriam-Webster, an internet meme is, I quote, an amusing or interesting item such as a captured picture or video or a genre of item that is spread widely online, especially through social media, and not, I quote Dawkins, something going viral on the internet. Actually, reposting is what people mean by saying something goes viral. However, as a practice, reposting has nothing to do with viral infection but is constitutive for memeing as I showcased. To conclude, I have identified three evolutionary stages of the term meme. In the first stage, before 2000, the term is defined by Richard Dawkins as a cultural unit that literally infects the human mind. Dawkins and some memeticists after him used the term to criticize religion. The term relates to a theoretical concept of cultural virality. In the second stage, as from 2004, the term is primarily analogized with image macros, which originated in subcultures like 4chan. The term relates to concrete internet phenomena. In the third stage, the one we are currently on, the term is more actively used as in memeing, which relates to the media practices of meme culture. How the term meme as well as meme culture are further changing in the future remains to be seen. Maybe you have some thoughts on it, which I would love to discuss at the conference in September. Thanks for watching. See you soon.